Coming up on Tech News Today, Waymo throws away some of its patent disputes with Uber. Jawbone is apparently shutting its doors and then reopening them somewhere else. Samsung is getting rich off of Apple. The new Spider-Man movie is apparently really, really good. And a musician is offering his album through the Ethereum network. Kind of interesting stuff there. Ron Richards joins me next on Tech News Today.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for Tech News Today is provided by CashFly at CACHEFLY.com.
This is Tech News Today, episode 1805, recorded Friday, July 7th, 2017. This episode of Tech News Today is brought to you by Grasshopper. Stay connected and run your business from your mobile phone with Grasshopper. To save $50 on your order, visit trygrasshopper.com/twit. Hello and welcome to Tech News Today. This is the show where we talk about some of the biggest tech news stories with people who are passionate about technology. I'm Jason Howell. I'm back, and then Megan's gone. We seem to be missing each other along the way, but I've got my good friend, my good pal, Ron Richards, joining via Skype. How's it going, Ron?
It's good to be back. Thanks for having me, Jason.
Absolutely. We've been looking forward to getting you back on here. I'm sure sometimes it's fun to talk about technology that isn't Android, but then inevitably, like, we bring you on and there's stuff that relates. Like, it's just in the news.
I did notice that. Well, it's good. I mean, it's ubiquitous. It's part of our world. But yeah, no, I enjoy any opportunity to talk about tech other than Android, or including Android, because we're not one-trick ponies. We enjoy all the technology world.
We're two-trick ponies.
Yeah, we're two tricks.
We talk about Android is the first trick and everything else is the other one.
That's a very good trick I learned in school.
Yeah, so. Good stuff. All right, let's get right into it. We've got some news to talk about, of course. Alphabet's lawsuit with Uber over the ride-hailing company's possible use of trade secrets taken from Waymo also happened to include four separate patent infringement claims. But in a hearing last month, Judge Alsup had advised that Alphabet may wish to drop the patent aspects of the case ahead of the trial. Alphabet has since decided to do that. They've jettisoned three of the four patent claims, as Uber told the court it no longer uses the technology that those patents actually covered. Uber considers this a victory, of course, saying it weakens Alphabet's case. They're also pointing out that Waymo is overpromising and can't deliver on its claims. They say Waymo has resorted to floating conspiracy theories, not rooted in fact, doing everything they can to put the focus on sensation rather than substance. What do you say? Is this sensational or substantive?
I think this is substantive. I mean, the fact that they dropped the additional patents that Uber's not using definitely is a win for Uber, that's for sure. But this case was described to me by and I feel like we're gonna make a lot of references to friends, but I have a friend in the Bay Area who works in technology who, when this case first surfaced, he's like, wow, if anything's gonna take down Uber, it's gonna be this case. Just because of the details of the movement of IP for, that the one guy carried with him from Uber to Waymo to Google to Alphabet, you know, and it's just like, it's a really bad case. And so if Uber can get any win to salvage anything to make this thing that much worse, or that much less, then they're obviously in a better position. But yeah, this one's a doozy.
Yeah, it's Anthony Lewandowski is the guy who left Waymo to work for Uber. And then, of course, you know, it's at least as detailed by the case, allegedly took 14,000 files with him. He's pled the fifth and he's since been removed from Uber. So he's no longer with the company. So, you know, the kind of view from the outside looking in is, oh, man, they're just kind of cleaning up mess after mess, not to mention all the other stuff that Uber's got going on. But this has the potential to really undo a lot on the technology side if Waymo can prove that Uber is using its technology by way of those stolen files. And I mean, removing those patents from the case because that technology is no longer in use, like I have a whole new appreciation for this whole process. Like they're in deposition right now, essentially. And I've been doing jury duty for the past almost month now. So I've got like all the lingo and I understand a little bit better than I did before jury duty, kind of the whole process here. And I would imagine that for Waymo, for Alphabet, they would have loved to have that extra stuff there. But the judge basically said like they're not using the technology anymore. And from a juror's perspective, the important part is that you understand and can stay awake through all of this stuff, right? So they're basically peeling away all of these pieces because you run the risk of coming to court, coming to the trial with way too much information and possibly overshadowing the most important things as a result.
Right. Yeah. And I think it's really telling that Lewandowski pleaded the fifth, which, you know, is, you know, there to protect people from self-incriminating themselves. But clearly, you know, like something wrong happened here. And now it's up to Alphabet and Waymo to weigh with the courts what is their best chance of proving what went wrong to get whatever injunction they want done. And of course, Uber feels attacked because they're in the race for the self-driving car.
Right.
Right. So this is definitely a, you know, Alphabet is betting on Waymo to come up with a self-driving car, and Uber's betting on themselves as well. And if Alphabet can use this law case to keep Uber's development from moving forward, that gives them a competitive advantage. So that, like, it's funny because, like, it is incredibly detailed and legal and all this sort of stuff. It's going to take years, but the ramifications of this case are enormous.
Yeah. And I mean, even Uber is saying what Waymo's doing is simply trying to slow down a competitor in the field, using the case as ammunition to do that. Another aspect of this that's getting trimmed down is that the judge had also requested Waymo to reduce its claim of trade secrets. They originally came out with 120 trade secrets listed. And I mean, for each and every one of those, they'd have to go into detail in this court case as far as, you know, both sides, all aspects of it. They've trimmed that down to 10 essential trade secrets. So it's the case is honing. That doesn't mean that it's a weaker case necessarily. Maybe it just means that there's more focus on the most important things, and that's not a bad thing. I don't think. It only seemed like a matter of time, but according to the information sources, Jawbone is entering into liquidation proceedings, though the company has yet to make a comment on this. CEO Hosain Rahman and a number of Jawbone employees apparently have reportedly jumped ship to form a new company, this Jawbone Health Hub, which is expected to create health products and services. So Jawbone goes away, but not really, because there's this other company where we're going to try and do a different device and not make you think of Bluetooth headsets anymore.
I don't know. I'm clearly not a genius or a successful businessman, but I have worked in marketing before, and my suggestion might be to drop the word Jawbone from your new company name. Just an idea.
Do you think having the word Jawbone in there for your product? I mean, Jawbone has a legacy. Is it good or bad for the brand?
No, I think Jawbone has a legacy, but I think it's bad for the brand if that legacy is going down in flames and you're in, you know, liquidation process and you're starting a new company. Start from scratch and just say from the people who brought you Jawbone or whatever. But I would say from a branding standpoint, it's like naming your new ship the Titanic 2. You know, like, I don't know if you really want to do that.
We don't really need to put that thought into people's mind right from the point that they step on the ship.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I mean, it's a bummer. Because I had a friend who worked at Jawbone that left last year. But the reason why was because the company was going down. It was like, yeah, no, it's not going well. So I was not surprised to hear this news hit today that they're in liquidation at all. You know, it's a bummer because they make good products. They were really at one point in time, they were a leader.
At one point in time, did you ever have one of those little Jawbone Bluetooth earpieces?
I never did have the Jawbone Bluetooth earpiece, but I do have and still use to this day a Jawbone Jambox, the little Bluetooth speaker.
Yeah.
Great speaker. Fantastic. Love it. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I'll continue to use it, you know, even if Jawbone's not around, it still works.
Yeah.
They were a good company. So pour a little out for another company going down the tubes.
I suppose we'll hear officially from them. I'm guessing the way these always seem to play out in the coming days, because suddenly it hits the news and they're like, okay, well, we have to say something about it. Jawbone actually stopped selling devices last September. And Jawbone and Fitbit have been going at it in litigation since 2015 regarding patent infringement, trade secret theft. Wow, that sounds very familiar, doesn't it? And really what this sounds like is Jawbone is transitioning to be a direct competitor with Fitbit. You know, they have job postings on Jawbone Health in a few different places that say ingesting a lot of data, whether it's heart rate, accelerometer readings, or other sensor readings. You can imagine a wearable of some sort to kind of compete with Fitbit. So
and that we as we've talked about a lot in the wearable, you know, vertical and stuff like that, health tracking and health devices are where it's at.
Yeah.
So, you know, if they think they've got something and they can develop something that's focused, I feel like one of the problems with Jawbone was that they got really, really wide in their offering, you know, from the headsets that we knew onto speakers. They were doing some stuff with, you know, they had the Jawbone, the little bracelet one. Mm-hmm. Right. So maybe they, you know, if they're just focused on health in the same way like a Fitbit is, they can be a little more successful.
Yeah. But can they take it down the Apple Watch? That remains to be seen.
I'm going to bite my tongue on that one.
Samsung gets knocked down and they get up again. Ron, you're never going to keep him down. Just saying. Samsung says that its Q2 operating profit has hit new heights, rising around 72% from this point last year to around 14 trillion won or $12.11 billion. Samsung's memory chip division, of course, is expected to be a boon for the company through the end of the year and beyond, as the memory chip market right now is exploding. Maybe exploding is the wrong word for a Samsung story. Sorry about that. Samsung's OLED displays continue to do well for the company as well. And a big reason for Samsung's success in both of those categories lies in Apple's business, and especially with the upcoming iPhone 8 that we've heard rumors about. It's expected to be sporting a next-generation OLED screen, and you can imagine that's going to be supplied by Samsung. So Samsung's, making lots of money off of Apple.
Not surprised. I mean, like, you know, that's the one of the things is that especially us in our little Android world, we define Samsung by the Galaxy and then, of course, the Note disaster of last year. But I feel like when we were last talking about what's his name, Lee Jae-yong's corruption court case, mm-hmm. And all that sort of stuff. You know, Samsung is bigger than one person or any product. I mean, it's what did I read? It's like a third of the GDP of South Korea.
Yeah.
Like it's an enormous company. Like, they make washing machines, microwaves, refrigerators, televisions, like all this sort of stuff. So I'm not surprised at all that they're doing perfectly fine. Like the cell phone business is such a small aspect of what they do. And I love the irony that they're profiting from Apple. So while competing with them, you know,
I mean, that just shows how smart Samsung has been in differentiating itself in all of these different markets, right? It's has its phone division, its own phones that it's creating. And, you know, by and large, they're some of the most profitable, most popular Android devices out there. But then the big competitor in the similar markets is the iPhone. And what do you know? Samsung's making money off of that, too, because they've got memory chips in there. They've got devices going on displays going on those devices. So it's like win-win all around the board. And you're right. We get stuck in our Android world in this little microcosm of, oh, Samsung, I'll always think of their exploding devices. That hasn't done a thing to Samsung in slowing its momentum. It's just still rocking. So
it's funny because I look at Samsung now as really like South Korea's GE or what GE used to be. I don't know what GE is now, but like there are just so many different divisions of the company that are innovating and have R&D and that are driving things. And like, and you find out that while they have consumer products, their B2B products are in other consumer products from other manufacturers, right? Like that's how big they are. They're just an enormous company and they're just like a huge global force.
Right. Now, this is all ahead of an earnings report that they are going to actually release on August 1st. So they like to put out these little teasers to kind of, I don't know. Personally, I see them thumbing their nose going, see, you thought, you didn't know. Chinese hardware maker Xiaomi had an awesome quarter as well, riding the ship after a rocky 2016. The company sent a memo to employees sharing that they've shipped 23.16 million smartphones in Q2, up 70% from Q1, setting a new record for the company. CEO Li Jun says this is the result of a refocused dedication to quality. Xiaomi has faced challenges with rival hardware manufacturers like Huawei and Oppo, and at certain points it's been like, oh, well, Huawei is the new Xiaomi and it's game over for Xiaomi. But I mean, it just, they just keep on rocking. And obviously they have bigger ambitions outside of China, which is their primary market. They want to get into the U.S. at some point and some other major markets like the U.S. I think that's going to happen.
I don't even know if they need to.
Yeah, you know? I know.
Like
right.
if they're doing so well with China and now they've really grown in India and like and you know all these emerging marketplaces and other markets that aren't as saturated as the American marketplace, why bother? You know, like all you're going to do is you're going to be in a very high profile, expensive marketing game against companies like Apple and Samsung and Google and all this right. other stuff. So why just do what you're doing? Like clearly they're doing something right. You know, especially after, you know, when Hugo Barra left, I thought that was going to be one of the main indicators of Xiaomi going, oh, it's not going as they planned. But they seem to have done fine just by them. Although I do wonder about the result of a refocused dedication to quality. Does that assume that at some point they're like, listen, don't worry about the quality. Just get the phones out, right? Like, it's a refocused dedication. That's
yeah. Well, I mean, and you know, if anyone has actually had a Xiaomi phone in their hands, like it's been a while since I've had, like I haven't had any of the recent ones, but Matteo Doni has brought some of them in. We've had other guests on All About Android bringing those devices. They're built really well. Like they're, yeah. Xiaomi devices are kind of the epitome of this current trend, at least in Android hardware, of high quality, low cost hardware that competes, that goes toe to toe. I've got the OnePlus 5 right now. I mean, you know, I'm amazed that for under $500, you get the quality of device that you get out of this. And this is kind of the new normal. And companies like Xiaomi, they're all competing for this marketplace. So I think you're right that, you know, competing in the U.S. market, like they probably want to get there because the U.S. market is so big and they're working to do that. They've made these patent licensing agreements with Nokia earlier this week, also Microsoft last year. So it feels like they're putting the pieces in place to do that. But they're doing all right outside of the U.S. Like you said, 328% year-over-year increase of sales in India. And that's just one extra market. So if they continue that, that's going to work really well for them.
And again, also with Xiaomi, what you always have to consider, which who know, we have no idea the implication of this, but there's got to be geopolitical restrictions in terms of trade agreements with China and things yeah. like that, and things going on in worlds that I prefer not to talk about that would affect their ability to break into the American market, and whether or not that's worth the hassle. And maybe it's more of a wait and see kind of approach, you know, at least into next year.
Yep. Comma.ai is moving beyond its canceled self-driving car kit. Not canceled, they open sourced it. But anyways, the Comma 1, if you remember us talking about that last year, and unveiling its latest product called Panda. This is an $88 dongle. It plugs into the car's OBD2 port to communicate with and record data sent from the various sensors that might be installed throughout the vehicle. Basically, any vehicle after like 93 or somewhere around there has this port, so you can just plug it right in. Apps on a connected phone enable collection and interpretation of all of that data feeding in. When asked why someone might need all of that data, George Hotz, who's the founder of Comma, told The Verge, quote, just to have it, you know, basically the data's there. So why not have it? Which I don't know what you do with a lot of that data, but there you go. Do you think this is a good pivot?
I don't know. I mean, I liked it a lot better before I saw that dude in the t-shirt and the sunglasses and that
George
in the article. Yeah. But no, I mean, it's cool to make these little kind of things that allow you to access data within your own cars. And there are people who are data junkies and hobbyists and things like that who would love right. to. I think the $88 price point is great. You know, like that makes, you know, for somebody who's into this stuff, that's a no-brainer.
Yeah, might have a hard time finding it. So they're printing the dongle with a 3D printer that they have. They're making 1,000 units right now, which the article says he hopes to sell. I would hope so. Wow. George Hotz said it's not meant necessarily for general consumers, more for enthusiasts and hackers, which is kind of what you're talking about. Yeah. That not every person in the world wants to plug some device into their car and capture all of that data to know, you know, how many times they hit 60 miles per hour and when, and you know, gas efficiency down to the, you know, down to the number, the specific number, whatever data you're pulling from there. Not everybody needs that.
I could actually see this for hobbyists or, you know, engineers or entrepreneurs who are trying to build things in the automotive space to get access to those sensors and to that data, and then to build things based off of those results of that. I think that this could really be like a gateway to other devices that can do interesting stuff with cars. I mean, who knows? I mean, it's interesting because this almost seems like a not as consumer friendly version of automatic.
Yeah, right. Yeah, we automatic, by the way, was a sponsor a few years ago, and I had the automatic plugged into my car for a long time, and I did like some of the data features of it, like gas efficiency, you know, finding that out versus just like following the odometer reading on my screen. It felt a little bit more precise and stuff like that. But and then you could kind of set it up, and as I'm sure you could with this too, to kind of automate things like your near home, so it turns on your lights or whatever. I didn't really go that far, not on my day-to-day use, but you could if you're a hacker or an enthusiast, if this is the kind of thing that intrigues you. There you go. And that is the top news. We're going to, first of all, let me remind you that you can discuss anything that Ron and I have talked about today. Email us tnt@twit.tv. You can also subscribe to the show if you haven't already. Tech News Today can be found at our show page at twit.tv/TNT. And as we do most Fridays, we're going to have Sam Moskovich from Ars Technica on to, give us, Sam anyways, saw Spider-Man. Ron almost saw Spider-Man. So we're going to try and not spoil it for Ron and see how the new Spider-Man film is, because I've heard it's very good. But first, let's take a minute to thank Grasshopper. That is a sponsor of this episode. Grasshopper is a virtual phone system that's designed for entrepreneurs. Grasshopper works just like a traditional phone system, but it requires no hardware purchase. You don't have to purchase anything additional hardware-wise because you already have it. You have a smartphone. With their iOS and Android app, callers can reach you wherever you happen to be because you've always got your mobile phone on you. Grasshopper allows you to keep your existing number so you can maintain your brand. When you make a call, your client's going to see your Grasshopper caller ID instead of your personal phone number. You simply select a toll-free or local number, record a custom greeting, add multiple extensions for your business, and toll-free numbers, of course, are supported. Those are great for marketing and making your business sound even more professional. You can set up department and employee extensions with custom call forwarding to any phone in the world. Get voicemails emailed to you as audio attachments if you prefer to get them that way. You can also send and receive SMS text messages from your business number, all from your device. Join the over 250,000 Grasshopper customers today. Plans start at just $12 per month, and you have a 30-day money-back guarantee. Turn your smartphone into a business line with Grasshopper. To save $50 on your order, go to trygrasshopper.com/twit. That's trygrasshopper.com/twit, and we thank Grasshopper for their support of Tech News Today. All right, the new Spider-Man movie, it's out in theaters today, and our guest, Sam Moskovich from Ars Technica, wrote up his review about it. You can find it right now. Welcome, Sam.
That's all my Spider-Man moves right there, if you're wondering. And wait, one of my fancy 70s disco moves.
It is. Are you Spider-Man?
No, it's just celebrating 7770. It's like everyone's celebrating the year of 77. It's just been all disco on the radio in Seattle where I live.
Oh, okay.
But that works for me in terms of Spider-Man, because there is a lot of motion and movement and joy to be had in Spider-Man Homecoming, which is out in theaters today. Clearly, Marvel Studios and Columbia Pictures were excited about how this turned out because they had a screening last week well in advance so that critics could have plenty of time to work up all of the praise they could imagine. Spider-Man Homecoming is great. I don't even know where to begin, but I'd say Tom Holland as the lead is incredible, because you may ask yourself, do I need another Spider-Man?
Another Spider-Man?
Well, how many Spider-Men have we had in the past decade?
Well, it's true. How many have we had?
He's the third. Let's give him a little credit. We had Tobey Maguire, then we had Andrew Garfield, who I thought was underrated. I know a lot of people didn't really like him, but I liked him as Spider-Man. And now Tom Holland, who after seeing him in Civil War, I was like, oh, he's going to be good in his own movie. And I'm glad to hear that that's the case.
But I will say 100% lives up to the hype. Spider-Man Homecoming definitely did come off of that very solid appearance in Civil War. Really, really good brief moment where you kind of set up why there was a new kid, how young and pokey he was, Marissa Tomei as Aunt May, that sense that there was already something going on there. And now they have the opportunity to flesh it out. And I think of it as Peter Parker's day off. This is Marvel Studios' first teen movie, in my opinion. They're really finding a way to break away from the typical Marvel action film and go, okay, let's make a teen movie with a really good teen cast. One of the stars, I'm blanking on his name, his last name is Daly, from Freaks and Geeks, is one of the writers on this movie, and it shows, because geekdom and excited kids who can act their way out of a paper bag are totally on display here. Peter's sidekick is just fall on the ground awesome in terms of just really stealing scenes everywhere he goes. The action's really good. Michael Keaton is incredible as a bad guy. And there's not really even damsels in distress. They really do a good job with Tom Holland of mining him as an excited, confident, but ultimately incapable superhero. He's young. He still has things to learn. And the mistakes he makes in this movie have stakes. He messes up and has to learn from it. It's really interesting, really compelling, and funny and entertaining the entire way through. I really feel like a cheesy movie poster. You know, the ones with the cheesy, like, three words about must go see when I talk about this movie, but I really do feel that way.
Sam Moskovich from Ars Technica says must see on the poster. I don't know, Ron, I know you had plans to see this morning, well, this afternoon, right before this show. Yeah. I'm sorry you had to choose the show over the movie.
Yeah, well, no, it's not your fault. No, I was actually, unfortunately, I wasn't able to attend any of the advanced screenings in New York for critics. So I'm like, all right, I'll just go Friday. I like to see it with a normal crowd usually as well, too, to get the kind of to register. And I went to see it at the Alamo in Brooklyn this afternoon. But unfortunately, somebody triggered the fire alarm in the building, and that killed the projector. And then I'm doing the math, and I'm like, I got to make it back to see Jason and do TNT. So I'm going to go see it tomorrow morning. But Sam, you know what Sam's saying is echoing a lot of the stuff I've heard from friends of mine who have seen the movie, both that work in the comic book industry as well as in, you know, kind of critics and things like that. I'm hearing a lot of comparisons that this is really Marvel meets John Hughes. Which, as a big fan of John Hughes films, that makes me very happy. And actually, I was texting with a friend of mine who works at Marvel in the comics section, in the comics division, and he said, in his opinion, this is the best Spider-Man movie of all, possibly one of the best Marvel movies of all.
Wow. Now,
that said, I always try to temper these opinions because comic book movies and comic book movie fans, and Sam, I don't know if you've run into this as well, too, they tend to love the newest, latest, shiny thing. Like every movie that comes out, oh, this is the best one and all this sort of stuff. So I like to see, you know, you go back and watch a movie a year later and see how well it holds up. But I think all indications show that this Spider-Man movie is really going to be something special because I think Tom Holland is just great as Spider-Man. And just like from the trailer alone, it's just like, oh, this looks like it's going to be fun.
I mean, I can already tell you this is nothing to do with comic book fanboyism. For example, as much as I love Paul Rudd, Ant-Man did very little for me. Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2 was just serviceable and fine. Not a bad movie per se, but this to me really goes somewhere different enough for the Marvel tentpoles to establish a new trajectory for at least a few movies, to have Robert Downey Jr. show up and anchor in a really good way. I do feel like the Downey era is gonna fade out before long. There's only so much Robert Downey Jr. that you can get in these movies before they go broke paying him. So I thought that there was a really good kind of handoff there, though I'm not going to go into any further detail as to what exactly that might be. But it just is exactly what it needs to be to feel fresh because we've had so many Marvel superhero movies that sort of blur the line. You're not a geek if you go see a Marvel movie anymore. They're just everywhere. Right. So how do you really step up and make a movie for everyone that really gets at a human connection level and has great characters that you really invest in and also see shades of gray in? And I think Michael Keaton, Tom Holland, the entire cast, knock that out of the park. It's a character movie, and that's why I love it.
Great. I guess I'm going to have to figure out a way to see that then. Because with two kids, yes, I have to figure it out, apparently. I would take them, but I don't know.
Don't you have an alter ego that you leave them behind with at 5 p.m.? Sorry, kids, I got to put on this costume.
See you later.
Yeah, I will say, Jason, I know your kids are probably a little young for it, but I was in the theater on an afternoon. It's in July, and half the theater was kids, so that was really promising and really good to see.
Yeah, but that's how it was at Deadpool, so that's there's some patterns. I will say it is pretty kid-friendly. There's like jokes that use slightly suggestive language and some punching and violence, but of all of the blockbusters that a parent may want to take a kid to, I would say this before many others.
Got it. Yeah. All right.
Well, good. And what I love is that Spider-Man's a teenager. He's a kid, and that's something new, and that's from the movies kind of standpoint, so I'm glad to see where it goes from here.
Right on. If you'd rather save yourself the trouble of heading to the movie theater for Spider-Man, perhaps you'd rather Netflix the new Castlevania series and chill. And by chill, I mean actually watch it. Sam, you actually watched it when you chilled, and you're working on a review. Was it worth your time?
Let's go with the phrase zero chill. Castlevania is the first video game to Netflix conversion that I can think of. If I'm wrong, someone please correct me. There certainly haven't been many of them, if any. And it's based on the 80s, 90s, and 2000s side-scrolling, whip-cracking series from Konami. Konami, now being mostly a pachinko game maker, have kind of fallen out of gamers' favor. And this series is not going to convince them that Konami is suddenly cool with video games again. Castlevania never had a ton of story, but certainly Symphony of the Night elevated it in terms of artistry and interesting little bits of dialogue. And other stories have tried to sort of tell stories of Belmont family members who crack whips and use spells and fight vampires. Yeah, this animated series, you don't really fight very many vampires. It seems like the creators have a real bone to pick with their Catholic school upbringing, because it's mostly battling with really stodgy church members of a, you know, generic cross-wielding church in the middle of Europe, even though nobody really has a crazy thick European accent. And you end up barely seeing Trevor Belmont, who is the character from Castlevania 3, Dracula's Curse. You barely see him actually fight any demons or monsters. He mostly stumbles around as a drunken jerk who cusses a lot, punches drunk people for no reason, curses like a sailor. I can't say pretty much anything that he said on this show without being uninvited for the rest of my career. It is like the Duke Nukeming of Castlevania, and I don't say that as a good thing. And then there's other just like buckets of gore out of nowhere. Castlevania has always been like E for 10, if not teen, tops. And whatever, somebody decided that it really needed to get adulted. Do not show this show to children, period. Do not show it to adults either, unless you're willing to slog through about 60 minutes of an 80-minute series. It really does seem like a straight-to-video movie that got sliced up into four 20-minute episodes. Oh. The very final 20 minutes finally gets somewhere. You're getting some monster killing, some vampire fighting, some whip cracking, some character development that isn't terrible. But you have to slog through 60 minutes of it in order to get to it. So if you're patient and you're willing to chill by, you know, hitting the mute button or check this, I've never felt so compelled to grab my phone and look up websites while watching a show. That is how slow and boring this show ultimately is.
That's obviously a bad sign when it's not holding your attention enough to forget that your phone is sitting right next to you. Netflix has already announced that it's ordered a season two. They ordered that today, or they announced it today. Today is the release of the series to begin with. Do you have any hope for season two based on the very last episode of this one?
A sliver, because it does end well. It sets up three characters who, by the way, all come from Castlevania 3, Dracula's Curse. Thank you, NES loyalists. And they're developed just enough where you go, I could see these three characters kind of riffing on each other and getting onto a real vampire battle against Dracula. But they're going to really need to completely redo everything and come up with a different pacing. If it got renewed because they saw potential in it, as opposed to because they wanted to retread the exact same ground, that'd be great. But I don't know why they renewed it already. It just came out, I guess, because it ends on a very obvious cliffhanger, since it's only four episodes anyway. So we'll see.
All right. Are you any excitement from you, Ron? I don't know how much of a Castlevania fan you are.
Not really, no. I mean, I was dialed into the Voltron Netflix series when that came out. That was fun. But the reason why is because I was a Voltron fan. I'm not necessarily a Castlevania fan. I really got to wonder. I mean, Sam, are you a fan of the Castlevania games going back to the, you know, the old Nintendo stuff? And is this more catered for those? Because I've got a friend who's a Nintendo, you know, he goes nuts for any of those old NES games and devours every, you know, movie, TV show, anything that comes from that era. Is that just who this is for?
Well, I mean, if your friend likes really terrible movies, then that's a great path, because video game to movie conversions are awful in general. Yeah. Now, this is better than like an Uwe Boll movie, but that's an incredibly low bar to clear. As far as being NES authentic, it doesn't feel like a video game. There's so much action that doesn't happen. There's so much slow pacing. And you also don't really get a great backstory to, pardon the pun, sink your teeth into. Other than they try to humanize Dracula for a minute, he falls in love with a woman, and then that woman is called a witch and burnt at the stake by this religious group, and hence tons of anti-Christian sentiment is kind of bubbling. And it's just very awkward and weird, and definitely does not feel like a video game. It's hard to take a game like Castlevania, which I enjoyed a lot in the 80s and 90s, and turn it into a full dialogue thing, since it's never been like a text-heavy quest. You're going around collecting items, killing monsters, but You don't get a lot of running around collecting items, killing monsters in this TV show.
They're not running around and collecting 200, 300 hearts in the course of 20 minutes.
Throwing the axe in the perfect arc, yes, you know, right. All the good stuff.
They missed an opportunity then, obviously. Finally, Sam, your colleague, Kyle Orland, he's been on the show a number of times, wrote a piece on the Super Nintendo's Super Effects chip. Tell us a bit about this chip. I was always kind of fascinated with it, even though there were hardly any games made for it, and its support on the SNES back in the day.
Yeah, the Super NES, like the NES before it, supported extra little chips that could be put into the cartridge. This was a way to add $5-6 to a cartridge to soup up what that cartridge could do on aging hardware. The NES had a ton of these, and actually Castlevania games used them to great effect on the NES to add extra sound effects. Look up FM Sound Castlevania on Google. It's quite a dive. Now, in terms of the SNES, they didn't have as much of that, but the Super FX chip was absolutely the stopgap that Nintendo needed while they were kind of taking their time getting a 3D system out. Remember, this was when 3DO and, other Jaguar and terrible, like, kind of 32 and kind of 64-bit systems were coming. They didn't necessarily take off, but that was enough where they said, okay, this extra chip will give us some 3D processing. Now, here's the thing. Nintendo loves reselling its old games. So you'll go and grab a virtual console on the Wii or the Wii U or the 3DS that's got tons of old games, but nothing that's ever had the Super FX chip in it has been resold. Other than Yoshi's Island, which actually was resold with as a modified version. The original game has never been resold. And over the years, people have wondered, has that been about a patent? Well, we did some digging over the past couple of days, and Kyle Orland at Ars found no patent has been the thing to stop Nintendo from doing this. This is basically just, we love talking about technology patents over at Ars Technica because it's amazing what some documents and red tape will do to stymie and stop technology from the past to be pushed forward. Turns out Nintendo, from what we can gather, has been holding off on these Super FX games just because it would be hard to convert them. Emulation is really funny in the game space because Nintendo would have to essentially re-engineer stuff without using any open source code. Sega right now has a thing called Sega Forever, and it stinks. Yeah. Its emulators are bad, and it's designed for smartphones, and it's clunky and stodgy. And Sega has gone and said, we could put out better emulators, but we can't use open source stuff without kind of giving away the rights to our games. Hmm. So it seems like it's a crazy soup of emulation and patents and re-engineering. And I heartily encourage anyone who's super interested in that sort of nerdiness to jump into Ars Technica's report looking at it. But short version is Nintendo finally said, we can make some money.
Yeah, right. And now with the SNES Classic right around the corner and Star Fox is included, that was running on this chip. Star Fox 2 was running on, I think, the FX2 chip, right? The Super FX2 chip.
Mm-hmm. And Star Fox 2 never came out. And in our emails, you used capitalization and exclamation points about Star Fox 2. And that is, I totally agree. Star Fox 2 has existed as an incomplete prototype, like 90 to 95% complete. Someone had a cartridge, leaked it out of a Nintendo office, and it got online, and people have been able to play what would have come out. But Nintendo at the time said, this is going to look bad compared to the PlayStation. We're going to just shelf it. And they shelved it, and we're going to finally get to play it thanks to the SNES Classic.
That's super exciting. I'm pretty pumped for that. Ron, any love for the Super Nintendo and kind of the classic coming out? Are you excited at all?
I have very fond memories of my Super Nintendo playing Super Star Wars for hours on end. That whole series was great. The side-scrolling Star Wars stuff, and up until Super Empire Strikes Back, when I couldn't down the AT-AT. But other than that, no. I mean, it's funny because this wave, you know, Sam mentioned that Nintendo loves to resell their games, but like this wave of, you know, retro gaming and like nostalgia, and you know, we saw the NES Classic kind of get released and then mysteriously not be released. Now the SNES Classic is announced. You know, I think it just shows the power of how good of a platform these were, that there's so many passionate fans for it.
Yeah. Yeah, super looking forward to it. I'm super looking forward to it.
Super FX forward to it?
Yes, Super FX 2, actually. Sam Moskovich from Ars Technica, thank you so much for joining us tonight. Really appreciate it, man. Always
a
pleasure.
It's always good to talk Super Nintendo with cool people. Good to see you guys.
Right on. Have a great weekend. We'll talk to you soon. All right, feedback time. Jim Stewart wrote in and says, I'm a long time, first time. Listen to your show as frequently as a new dad can. I've been trying to baby-proof my house as much as possible. I've connected some of the off-the-shelf common cabinet locks. They're cheap but cumbersome. I'm looking for a 21st century and time-saving solution. I've found two Bluetooth proximity locks as followed. And then he linked to a couple of those, which we'll show here in a second. He says, they will likely work when paired to smartphones, one Android and one iOS device, but not at their price point at $50 for every lock. I've considered a DIY project using a Raspberry Pi and electric magnets. However, that seems like a lengthy solution to implement. I would agree. Please let me know if you have a solution for locking kitchen cabinets and drawers with a proximity sensor that won't break the bank. P.S. Kiddo is 8 months old, and locking kiddo from the kitchen via gate isn't an option. I understand your feels here. This could be one area where there's very little going on when it comes to high-tech house. Because I did some poking around, I did some searching, I couldn't find anything. It's all low tech, the same ones that he's talking about here, the same ones we used on our cabinets that stick to your things so hard that when you don't need them anymore, you can hardly remove them and they leave all this residue and you got to go nuts with goo off in order to get it all gone. So it really seems like these two things that he linked to, CleverKey at cleverkey.com, and then the Smart Cube, which is an Indiegogo thing that finished, but it hasn't released yet. So anybody that got in on it, this is actually a high-tech version that they even tout in the Indiegogo campaign that you could use it to lock, you know, for baby-proofing and stuff. I don't know of anything other than these.
I don't know either. I wonder if there's some, I was thinking and joking that by the time he homebrew built one, like either with Raspberry Pi or whatever, his kids will be old enough that it doesn't matter. But if there are more dedicated folks, I wonder if there's something with NFC that could be done where if you put an NFC sensor on a lock, just tapping your phone would then unlock it or whatnot. There's got to be smart people who are, you know, a lot of the maker audience type folks, doing something around this. As we've seen the smart home develop, you're right. This is one area that really haven't seen any innovation between these two. That's really, really, really interesting. But then again, I don't want a Bluetooth lock for my phone. Like I think NFC would be way better, the way better choice, the way to go. But
I would agree. And hey, anyone who's listening who has more more drive and motivation than I do, I can't speak for you, Ron, but I'm not going to design one of these. But that sounds like a really good idea. Get on it.
I
think you could totally create something pretty awesome. And who knows, maybe you can, Jim, if you actually take the time to figure this out on your own, maybe you'll create the thing that actually ends up selling and you can go to Indiegogo and make lots of money. So great idea. Maybe folks who are listening or watching know of something that we've missed. If you do, TNT at twit.tv, let us know. TNT's fan of the day is Dale Kiernan, who sent us this pic. This picture showing off his AirPods and saying high tech, low tech. So I imagine the high tech is the AirPods. The low tech is whatever that stuff is in the background. I'm not really quite sure. Is it cubes of dirt? I don't even know.
What are those?
I don't know, but it looks like he's...
Are they bricks?
I don't know. I stared at this image for a while trying to figure it out. But then again, on Wednesday, we had a screenshot of the Tour de France. And I came on the show and said, I don't know what bicycle race this is. Meanwhile, there was a sign right there. So don't trust me in analyzing these pictures. It's probably pretty obvious to you, but I don't know. Show us how you watch or listen to TNT. Just record a video or take a picture of yourself or your setup. You can post it on Instagram, Google+, Twitter, or Facebook and use the hashtag #HowIWatchTNT, and we will find it. Finally, Ron, you sent this link. I thought this was super interesting. Cryptocurrencies. Yeah. I feel like they're super confusing, can be confusing anyways. Try as I might, I'm always kind of struggling to learn the complexities around that. For example, I never knew that a musician could release an album on the Ethereum network, and apparently neither did any other musician, except for Imogene Heap, who I think did this with a single.
Just a song.
Yeah, just a song. Grammy Award-winning DJ producer RAC, or Rack, is to be the first to do this with a full album. Andre, as I'm sure his parents call him, plans to release his latest album, Ego, on July 14th, to be distributed on the Ethereum blockchain. And I was like, okay, well, how does that work? So basically, you're cutting out the middleman, by supporting the artist directly. So instead of the artist putting their music into Spotify or Apple Music and they take 30%, or even Bandcamp takes a certain percentage or whatever, you're basically putting this up through your own site and offering purchase through the controlled Ethereum blockchain ecosystem, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, basically, why I thought this was really interesting and why it jumped out to me, of course, because, you know, we're both fans of technology, and I know, Jason, you're a fan of music as well as I am. I had a conversation with a friend of mine who works in blockchain technology, specifically in the financial markets, but he also is a musician, and we were talking about, you know, what can be done with blockchain, and he explained to me, this is right before Imogen Heap did the single last year, about how blockchain could be applied to music royalties. And so, like, again, to be clear, the music itself is not distributed via blockchain, right, or Ethereum or Bitcoin or anything like that. The music itself is in a file repository, and you get that, whatever. It's all about the payments. And what blockchain allows you to do is it allows you to funnel payments so that everyone involved in the production of that album gets their due percentage for every purchase. Right. So like no matter where it's sold or no matter what platform it is or whatever, you know, if you and I did an album together and we said, OK, great, we get 50-50 of the proceeds, when the payment comes through the blockchain, it ensures the fact that you get your 50% and I get my 50%, because it's, you know, it's kind of piggybacking on what, you know, what they've done with Bitcoin and Ethereum and stuff like that through blockchain technology. So it's really, really interesting. Not mainstream friendly at all. Absolutely not mainstream friendly. But what we're seeing here is with the single by Imogen Heap, and now this album by this DJ Rack or RAC or however he calls himself, you're seeing, you know, the beginnings of experimenting with it. And now it's up to the cryptocurrency companies and, you know, music specific blockchain companies to figure out how to make it easier for the average user, you know, so you don't need an Ethereum, you know, you don't need Bitcoin through Ethereum, you don't need anything like that, so you don't need to go to Coinbase or anything like that to buy it, but how can you actually do sales and ensure that the artists get paid the percentage that they're due? I think it's fascinating, and this is the beginning of possibly the direction to help save the music industry, if you want to believe it in air quotes. But there's a great article by Imogen Heap on hbr.org that came out a couple of weeks ago where Imogen Heap explains why the approach to the single and how they did it and what it means for the music industry. And this came out before the news, RAC doing it. So yeah, I mean, it's good. This is definitely something to watch.
Interesting. I mean, if this is the beginning of something, this is like the very, very beginning, because this is such, like you said, and this is how I feel about blockchain and cryptocurrency, is that awareness around how to use this. It's almost like you're someone who's rarely been exposed to this. Their mind immediately shuts down the second you start talking about cryptocurrency. Yep. Or you start talking about Ethereum network. All you have to do is go to Coinbase and blow, you know. And so getting them past that point of difficulty to be comfortable enough to buy into this. But if Andre, as I like to call him, is doing this, I'm sure he understands that he's limiting his audience, but he's potentially setting some sort of a path, some sort of an example. And maybe he actually feels like his audience is capable enough to go along for the ride. I certainly appreciate the reasons behind it, you know.
Yeah, his justifications were really interesting. I encourage anybody to go to Motherboard on Vice to read the full interview with him to see kind of why he wanted to do this and all this stuff. And this is not a new, like, this is his fifth album. So this is not something that he's, you know, like, he's no novice. Like, he's doing this very strategically. Like, he recognized the album's going to get out there. Let me do something cool with it to get some attention towards this. Yeah. And then it's going to be available through other ways down the line, I'm sure. Sure. You know, but yeah, very, very, very interesting, and very, could be the beginning of an interesting trend.
I'm getting ideas. This might be a good idea. I would certainly learn something if I went this way.
Yeah.
Ron Richards, always fun, man. Thank you so much for sacrificing your viewing of Spider-Man to join me here today.
It's okay. I already got tickets for tomorrow morning, and it's great because it's great to be here. It's always great to talk about technology. But for those who don't know me, I also talk about comic books and comic book movies and TV shows and stuff over at ifanboy.com. And we're going to have our Spider-Man review up probably tomorrow after I see the movie, or Sunday. So just go to ifanboy.com and you can see that, and you can hear what I thought of Spider-Man after I see it.
Right on. Excellent. Yeah. And of course, All About Android every Tuesday here on the Twit Network. We were out this week because of the 4th of July, but we'll be back next Tuesday.
Which I got to admit, not doing All About Android on Tuesday threw my week off.
Yeah,
like,
it's weird.
You wouldn't believe. Like, it was like, what am I, what? Like, that I realized that All About Android has become like my tent pole on the week. And I just kind of play, it's all leading up to the show and then prepping for the next show and not doing it for a week threw me for a loop. That was crazy. But yeah, so check out All About Android and also check out my other show with Tom Merritt, a Damn Fine Podcast, where we're talking about Twin Peaks. And follow me on Twitter at RonXO.
Right on. Thanks again, Ron. Talk to you soon.
Thank you, Jason.
TNT records live every Monday through Friday, 4 p.m. Pacific, 7 p.m. Eastern, 2300 UTC at twit.tv/live. You can be part of the show by emailing us, and I hope that you do, tnt@twit.tv, and we'll read that on the show. You can leave us a short voicemail, 260-TNT-SHOW, and find us on Twitter. We're at TechNewsTodayTV. Of course, we have a subreddit, technewstoday.reddit.com, where you can place your links for the show, and we check in on that, vote things up, down, maybe sideways if they allow us to do that. And you can find all the ways to subscribe to the show at twit.tv/TNT. If you want to reach out to me directly, you can find me on Twitter. I'm at Jason Howell. Thanks to our technical director, Anthony, for pushing buttons and helping out here in the studio. Thanks to Mario for helping out in the studio as well. And thanks to Kevin for editing the show today. And thanks to you for talking tech with us today. We'll see you all on Monday. Have a great weekend. Bye, everybody. High five. It always goes the right. Yeah, the right.
Big hand.